of the 2014 midterm election are still coming in overnight. First, though, we want to start off taking a look at the winners in the big races. For U.S. Senate, incumbent Al Franken beats Republican Mike McFadden with a pretty big margin, 53% to 43%. In the race for Minnesota's governor, Mark Dayton wins his second term, no recount this time, over challenger Jeff Johnson, 50 to 45%.
To the race for Minnesota's 8th district congressional seat, around 12:45 this morning, the race was called. Incumbent Rick Nolan held off challenger Stuart Mills. We talked about the impact of that third party vote here, with only 4,000 votes separating Nolan and Mills right now. Ray Sandman getting 11,000 of those votes certainly did impact this race. Now, Republicans still had a great day at the polls, causing a shift of power at the state capitol.
The GOP has taken back control of the Minnesota House, while Democrats did well in the metro. Rural areas were good to the GOP.
5 Eyewitness News reporter Kate Renner is live at the Capitol this morning with what this means when the legislature convenes in January. Kate.
Well, the Minnesota State Legislature is now going to be a House divided. For the past 2 years, Democrats have controlled both the House, the Senate, and the governor's seat. But due to a surge in GOP votes in rural areas, they were able to take back at least 7 seats necessary to regain control of the House.
That's a big governing challenge for Governor Dayton, because he works much better with Democrats than he does with Republicans, and his inability to work compromises with the Republican legislature in the first 2 years of his first term led to a government shutdown.
Now, there's not an exact official count on which seats the GOP picked up yet this morning. Some of those seats will need to be recounted, but unofficially, the GOP nabbed 72 seats. Democrats took home 62 seats, and House Speaker Democrat Paul Thissen conceded earlier this morning. Now, that's big news for House leadership. GOP Representative Kurt Dowd is the front runner to be voted the new Speaker of the House.
He was the leader for the Republicans, raised a lot of money, recruited a lot of these candidates, worked on the campaign. So he'll be, I think, kind of the new face for Republicans in Minnesota.
And coming up at 6:30, we're going to take a look at some of the big issues that will need to be tackled this legislative session and how Democrats and Republicans are going to have to compromise in order to accomplish anything next year. Reporting live in St. Paul, Kate Renner, 5 Eyewitness News.
Now for some perspective, Catherine Pearson is here, a political science professor at the U of M. Let's talk about the GOP taking the state house.
Well, this means that Republicans will be able to put the brakes on some major DFL initiatives in a way that they were unable to do over the past 2 years when a lot of legislation was passed. That said, there will be many bipartisan coalitions, as Minnesota has a constitutional requirement to balance the budget. And so we'll see possibly some compromise, possibly again some shutdown threats.
What do you think it means? I mean, we've seen this back and forth the last 3 election cycles as far as who gains control here. What do you think it says about the state of Minnesota, about voters out there today?
Yeah, that the Minnesota State House is up for grabs. And I think that in the years to come, we'll continue to see shifts between party control of Republicans in the DFL. And so that means that, you know, to some extent, there's always looking toward the next election. But it also means that there's added incentives to compromise.
Okay, interesting. We're going to keep Catherine here with us this morning, bring you in a lot throughout the course of the morning, kind of get your perspective on things.
Great.
Catherine, thanks. Well, we know that it was a good night for incumbents running for U.S. House in Minnesota. In District 1, Democrat Tim Walz won. In District 2, Republican John Klein won. In District 3, it was Republican Eric Paulson. Democrat Betty McCollum took Sharna Walgreen, and the popular Keith Ellison won by a big majority there. Veteran Democrat Colin Peterson, we know, will keep his seat as well.
In the 6th District, former gubernatorial candidate Tom Emmer won the seat, being vacated by fellow Republican Michelle Bachmann. He beat out Democrat Joe Persky, 56 to 38% of the vote.
We are honored to be here with you. We're honored to be part of your team. We're looking forward to some big things tonight. Let's go out and make some changes in this country.
Transportation was a major issue in this race. Emmer favored fixing roads and bridges as a priority over extending the North Star commuter rail.
Now, in the 8th district, the race was one of the most hotly contested in the country.
But Democrat Rick Nolan was able to keep Republican challenger Stuart Mills at bay. Reporter Jennifer Ann Wilson tracking results from the newsroom this morning. Jen, I think it's important for people to know that this race is officially still about 95% of the precincts in, so not all the precincts have reported.
No, it is not over yet, but we have gotten a victory speech already from Rick Nolan, so he seems very confident about those final precincts. And just 24 hours ago, things weren't looking so good for our incumbent, Rick Nolan. But this morning, he has become a bright spot on an otherwise dismal day for Democrats. After that victory speech that he gave early this morning, he told us he's ready to dive into his second term.
And hopefully, you know, the Republicans will have the good sense to put partisanship aside and let us start working together and give democracy a chance. And let's all go to work, fix things, and get things done.
Well, meanwhile, early this morning, challenger Stuart Mills also gave a speech. He thanked his team for their hard work and reminded them that the election results are not final, and he's not ready yet to admit defeat.
When I see the final numbers, there's a very good likelihood I will be extending Representative Nolan, based on those numbers, the courtesy of a phone call, possibly congratulating him.
Right, so it is important to note, as Chris mentioned just a minute ago, that only 95% of the 8th District precincts have reported, which means there are still 42 we're waiting to hear from. I am keeping a close eye on those numbers, and I'll let you know as soon as I get any more information. Now, this race was one of the most expensive congressional campaigns in the nation, and coming up in the next half hour, you'll hear what Nolan hopes to do to prevent an expensive race like this one from happening again. Back to you guys.
Okay, Jen. Wisconsin now. Governor Scott Walker will serve a second term. He was declared the winner over Democrat Mary Burke. Walker expected to make a presidential run. And while he downplayed talk of a White House bid during a campaign, he did seem to be speaking to people across the country, not just Wisconsin, in his victory speech.
To all of you who voted for me, thank you. And for those who didn't, I hope to earn your support, at least, and your respect over the next 4 years, because we got a lot of work to do.
Walker also took a few shots at federal politicians during his speech. And another shift of power at the national level.
Republicans have now seized control of the U.S. Senate in a wave of Election Day victories and really strengthened their grip on the House. Reporter Brandi Powell joining us now with more on this. Huge for Republicans, Brandi.
Yeah, big night for Republicans. They had sweeping victories. They only needed 6 seats to win, but they won at least 7. As expected, they picked up Arkansas, South Dakota, and West Virginia. They also won North Carolina, Colorado, and Iowa, and there are at least 3 races that are still too close to call. Now, in the House, Republicans did well. Also, they're on track to have the most members in more than 60 years. Republicans also dominated in the governor's races, even knocking off the Democratic governor from the president's home state of Illinois. Now, this was not a surprise for President Obama, these Republican wins. They've spent the last few weeks, planning on how to deal with the Republican-led Senate. Obama and congressional leaders plan to meet Friday at the White House. Megan.
All right, Brandi, we want to bring back in our political science professor, Catherine Pearson, now to talk a little bit about this. A big blow for Democrats. Clearly, the voters are not happy here. What do you think contributed to this?
Well, there are many factors that contribute. The victories for Republicans were not unexpected. In a midterm election cycle where Democratic voters are less likely to turn out, younger voters are less likely to turn out, voters of color less likely to turn out, 2 key groups in Democrats' coalition, that affected Democrats. But more than that, an unpopular president in President Obama really affected Democratic incumbents, particularly in red states and swing states. And so all of those things combined to make it a very tough night for Democrats nationwide.
Well, I mean, I think this was expected. States like South Dakota, Arkansas, West Virginia, but Iowa, this one's a particular sting to President Obama.
Absolutely. Iowa, of course, vacated by Senator Tom Harkin, a long-serving Democrat, retiring. This race was competitive all along. But again, in a midterm cycle where Democrats are not faring well, Republican challengers really did well.
Catherine, thank you. We're going to check back in with Catherine throughout the course of the morning, so stay with us here for more on that.
Thank you.
Now, for Minnesota's independents and Green parties, the goal this election day was not so much winning. It was more about nailing down major party status. The Independence Party wants to keep it. The Green Party wants to get it back. They need at least 5% of the vote, or it reverts to minor status. And the distinction matters.
And as a major party under state law, you are eligible for state funding for your party operations. If they get below 5% in all the statewide races, they are no longer eligible for that money, and they lose a big opportunity for resources. And if you don't have resources, you can't be an effective political force.
Right now, the only independent candidate that's close is Bob Helen, who's running for Secretary of State. The Green Party was hoping former Democratic State Representative Andy Dawkins could get the 5% in the Attorney General race. He only brought in 1% of the vote.
We have full election coverage for you on our website, kstp.com. There you can see the latest results from all of our state races. And we have plenty more election coverage for you here this morning. Coming up, we'll take another look at the state's top races.
There is other